سبيل الدموع سبيل مريح تنهد يا صاحي كي تستريح وغص الدعاء الخفي.
Think of some signs about the roots that are in you. When I share more, had it been that Allah's will, the Janah of Allah, you have guided them all in guidance. You know what Allah said? If I will, to make all these people believe in you and pronounce you. For that, the Janah of Allah, therefore, do not be of the ignorance. You can see and now the picture of what is happening here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding and appealing to his mercy in a very strong manner that the patient, and in the statement you can see the statement of the promise that the help will come. The help will come. And the last word in the verse is said that don't be of the ignorance. Allowing the anger, your anger to come between you and these people who are not doing something good. You see, and so this is a picture of what we are facing. The Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is exactly what Allah expects as he and so, back to our story. And before we get to the real point, which is regarding this part, in the other session, we talk about the situation where the Prophet tried to convince the people outside Mecca and what they did to him. And what happened between him and the Christian address, who is covered that in fact, Prophet Muhammad was a messenger of Allah and linked to him. And we also talk about his way back, as he was disappointed by this people. His way back in Wadi Anafna, a place halfway between that place and Mecca, his encounter with the jinn. Did he see them? And the jinn found him standing reciting the Quran in prayer in midnight. And they hear the Quran and they knew exactly what it was, that this is the new message that has come to mankind. And they believed in him and went to propagate the message. We talk about that. That was where I was. Now, after that event, Prophet Sallallahu was reluctant to come back to Mecca without protection, because that would be like coming back to the world. And so fortunately, in that hour, he found a horseman. The horseman was passing. And he called upon him and then he asked him for a favor. He asked him for a favor, he said, at least you deliver my message, a message to Al-Akhlas ibn Surayy. This man was a chief of tribe of Zubra, which was actually the tribe of the wife of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the late Khadija. So the message was that he was asking him to please grant him permission as a protection so that he enter Mecca back safely, and the protection was allowed him to be able to carry on with his mission. But the horseman being so kind, he even promised to bring the message back, the reply, the answer back. So he went very fast and he went and he delivered the message. But Agnes declined. He refused to grant such a protection, citing reasons that have to do with tribal comfort, a Christian. So he refused. The horseman brought the message. Again, the Prophet sent him to another chief Suhail. But the answer was the same. They want to come. They want to not mention their stand against this religion being the reason that they cited some, you know, social abuse as an excuse not to grant them the protection. So finally, he had to approach yet another chief by the name Mutu. The Mutu was kind. In fact, if you remember when we talk about the revocation of the ban, he was the one who actually organized that uprising against that unjust ban. So the chief, even though he wasn't a Muslim, they were so kind to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So, but the message brought to me that Muhammad was out there asking for protection so he would enter Mecca. He said, yes, of course. He sent a message back to him. He said, you can come. I'll grant you such protection. So the next morning, when they came out with his tribal men, his family members, sons, his nephews, you know, well armed, and they came in the visit of the Kaaba. There, very big, they announced that yes, we have granted protection to Muhammad when he came in the town. When Abu Jahl saw him, he approached him and asked, have you become Muslim? Mutim just said, well, we grant him protection. I'm talking about protection. We have granted Muhammad protection, and Muhammad is allowed under our protection to enter the city. So that was how that sort of crisis ended. The Prophet Sallallahu once again was back in Mecca, and this time under the protection of the back to our topic of the land, Islam. It was the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. You see, that is sister of Ali ibn Abi Talib, has a sister by the name Umhan. Now, Umhan is the daughter of late Abu Talib. She was a Muslim. And her husband, Ubaybah, was in the Muslim. Umhani, for us, has been close to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi before the revolution came. And so Umhani now is a Muslim. And so time to time, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to come to her house. And when he came to her house, the husband, even though he wasn't a Muslim, but he was a Muslim against the message of his father. And so, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was always welcome to the house. And in some occasions, when he came there, the few people that the team actually do pray Salat Jama, he led them in prayer and so on. Sometimes he invited me to spend night in their house. And so was this occasion, that one night after dinner and after the prayer of Isha, she asked the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam to stay for the night. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, you know, accepted that kind gesture. And so he was there. At the night after the prayer, when they slept, he woke up and decided to go to the masjid where he was praying now, prepared to spend his time. And so he left them in the house at night, and he went inside the masjid with the power. Therein, he did whatever was to, or he wanted to, you know, prayers. And then he fell asleep. He fell asleep, upon which, as he narrated the story later, that him, then he felt a knock. Someone saw nothing with his leg, but he just felt some sort of knock, as if someone was trying to open up. So he woke up and he sat up. But he turned left and right and he didn't see anyone. So he continued to sleep. And the second time, again, same thing. And so they woke up again, but couldn't see anybody around. And so he slept again. But the third time, he woke up and beside him was Jibril al-Salam. And he was standing beside him. In fact, he held him by the hand and, you know, wanted to stand. The Prophet was standing just beside him. And then, he led him outside the masjid. He led him outside the masjid. The Prophet said, outside the masjid, I found an animal, a white beast, bigger than a donkey, but a little smaller than a horse. A white in color, the wing was 2 minutes. And he was asked by Jibril, he was ordered to see one. And he sat on his animal. By the name, the animal has a name, and he used to say, Brock. Brock, maybe we should just take a few seconds to explain this word. Brock, the word Brock is like bark. Bark in Arabic means lighting. Lighting. But bark, burak. Burak is superlative degree of the same word. And so, if you think lightning is fast, you are taking superlative. I mean, this animal is faster than lightning. But who is burak from bark? Okay, he's suffering, and together with the boy, they moved northward, all the way to Jerusalem. There, when he arrived, all the prophets that preceded before him were gathered. And he was then asked to lead them in prayer and lead them. After the prayers, again coming here to embark on the work. But before that, he said, I was, 2 vessels were brought to me. One full of milk, another one wine. He said, I took the one with the milk and I drank. I gave it back. And Jibril said, oh, by choosing the milk, you've chosen primordial power, natural power. And it means that you're taking that wine, your own man, or your people, rubbing salt. And so he was kind of in that exercise to learn the right thing. But after that, he again was ordered to sit on the throne. Now he has sent up. He ascended to the first heaven, where the being having knocked the door, and he was asked, who is with you? And he said, Muhammad. And then the door was opened, and he was welcomed in there. And Prophet Sallallahu proceeded to narrate the story of his encounter in this journey. Now, during the journey, now then he, Jibril alayhi salam, sort of turned from his human form that he usually can when He comes to the Prophet and took up his own lunch on a fork. The angelic a fork. As the Prophet described, he said he has 600 wings and 19 animals. And the Prophet himself, sort of, he now perceived his in a spiritual way, what is spiritual capacity. This is beyond physical. From there on, and he has seen incredible things. That the journey continued to the heavens, to the seventh heaven. And in each stage, he has made some progress. In fact, in the first heaven, he met Yusuf A.S. See, when he met them, he just led them in prayer, where they appear to be in their bodily form. Now, however, he was seeing them in their celestial reality. And he described Yusuf alayhi salam in the government, beauty Allah has given me. In the second heaven, he has seen, among others, Prophet Haroon alayhi salam. And in the sixth heaven, he saw Musa alayhi salam. In the seventh, there was Ibrahim alayhi salam. The encounter, there were a lot of stories that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam over the years continued to really tell the stories. But briefly, as they move now from the seventh heaven, they will fail to a point where the Archangel Jibril alayhi salam stopped. And the Prophet said, "Where is it? Let's go." He said, "No, this is my limit." And asked him to proceed. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went fair. From there on, when he described, after that, this is beyond the same heaven. Somewhere, to a point where he said, "I saw not three." Three. And he described the tree. He said, "The leaves are like the side of elephants here." And he described the fruits, the side of the fruits, like the ball. He said, "I was standing there looking at the tree. Suddenly, some radiation of light sort of descended upon the tree, and he turned to something so beautiful that I cannot describe anything in this world." Now, this reminds us of the phrase he used during the prayer. After that encounter of Tariq, he said, "I seek refuge in the light of your countenance." Perhaps the light. Now he's talking about light, the beauty of which he cannot describe. It is on this point that he has direct communication with Allah and the world. Direct communication. Communication only in what concerns us. The communication apparently contains certain things that are between Allah and His messenger and you. What concerns us, we can. So, because he told us, during this conversation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala formally genuinely the prayer, this prayer that we. And the prayers were given, 50 prayers per day. Instead of five, 50. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this is your As he narrated the story, so when I was coming back after having come, when I reached Musa alayhi salam in 6th grade, he asked me, what have you got for your Lord? Anything special he said this? He has given me 50 prayers, me and my people. Musa alayhi salam objected. He said, oh no, this is too much. You see, my people were physically stronger than your people. But even them, they could not do this. So I suggest you go back and ask for protection. And the Prophet was sent up, he led to God, and he went back. And he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for protection, and 10 was taken out of the 15. He was now giving 40. So he came back, telling the story to Musa alayhi salam. Again, Musa alayhi salam objected. He said, ah, this is too much. He asked him to go back and ask for the life. This back and forth continued until it was 10 and he went back again. And 5 was deducted, and Allah said to him that it is now 5. There were 5 amounts to 50 in terms of the world. And the Prophet now came down and he again met Musa alayhi salam and said, my Lord, as a new answer, he accepted. Now it is 5 that he has given you, but the 5 he said amount to 50 in terms of the world. Musa said, that's very good, but still. I suggest you go back. The first class of the then I told myself, well, I went back and forth, now I'm ashamed. I was ashamed to go and ask a friend. I think it's just enough. So that was how that conversation ended. And he and Jibril now look back on the ground. Jibril alayhi salam beside him back to Jerusalem. There in Jerusalem, they journeyed back to Mecca. This incident recorded in Quran, obviously. But Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, subhanahu alladhi asra bi 'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa. Subhanahu, certainly he is he, Allah. He who had journeyed with his servant. Laden at night, with the Masjid al-Haram, from the Grand Mosque of Mecca, with the Masjid al-Aqsa, to the Federal Mosque in Jerusalem. Masjid al-Aqsa, Ladi Barakna Hawa. That was surrounding or preaching we are blessed to the Jerusalem. We are in the ayat, so that we will show you in our sign, of our signs. No one was saying on the sign, but he is the most caring of sin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the incident has been recorded clearly in the Quran. Now, you have scholars discussed, not argued, but rather discussed whether this journey was a dream or a physical. You will find some Muslim scholars who think that it was physical, but it was a dream. And you have many scholars that say, no, this is physical. And by all indication, it wasn't just a dream, it was physical. It was physical. All indication of that is physical. Taking the dream, dream happened like lightning. You know, right here in the second one, in Singapore, in Tushaka. When we have an account of the journey, the kilometers, inch of past of whatever, in the Jebali Sea. You are now describing the trees, the roads, whatever, from the Jebali Sea. And so it was this man. Now, in short, he came back from the Mosque back to home. The only thing happened before dawn, between after Isha, before dawn prayer. Now, here was he in the house of Tumurane, who had prayed the dawn prayer. Then he told her, he said, I prayed Isha with you, right? He said, yes. So then I left her, I went into the mosque. When the angel of the came and took me to Jerusalem. And by God, I'm going to tell people this story. She was terrified. She said, you can't do this. You can't tell them because they're. They will say, well, I, this will make a problem with you. She said, when he said, I'm going out, she grabbed him. Until the robe of his, garment, she sort of, tell that. And the Prophet and he went into the mosque. He found people there to give to tell him that. You see, he didn't even tell them about their sin. They would not bear that. He didn't even tell them that I was sent or that I went to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala above the seven heavens. That part he didn't even say. He just mentioned about the general form, the grand mosque of Jerusalem. And people are why. They didn't accept it. Some people rushed on the Prophet ﷺ. They said, right, today, your friend is exposed. Things are now, if you hear what he said, then yourself, you will know who your friend was. He said, what is it? He said, well, you know, the journey from here, Makkah to Jerusalem is a month journey, one month going, 1 month coming. Isn't it? He said, yes. He said, what is it? He said, Muhammad said, he claimed, in the Muslim right now, that last night, during the night, he went to Jerusalem and came back. Our mother asked him, did he see that? Or you are just making up a story? He said, yeah, he said, young you can go right now in the Masjid, tell you the story. He said, okay. If he said so, then I believe. Because he's been telling me more than what you people are saying. He's been telling me of the message he's been receiving from Allah every day, but I believe in him 100%. That's more than what you people are telling me. That's no news to me, you know. I believe in him. He came into the mosque to meet the Prophet himself. That is why they will say the Prophet said, yes indeed. I journeyed to Aqsa and came back. That's why he said, I believe in you. Then the Prophet called him As-Siddiq. As-Siddiq, the witness of it, or the confirmer of truth. Just to sum up. Now they begin to question. They could not make up this, and they thought this was just too much. But very soon they begin to calm down, because as they begin to question, they say, okay, tell us about Jerusalem. They begin to get information coming from him. That is, now they begin to wonder. He said, well, let me tell you, there was a caravan coming back from Syria. They were coming back and they were on the way. He saw them. And so he mentioned about this caravan in the week. He told them the location. fish. He told them when they will arrive in Mecca. So they both, they said, okay, let's go and see. They were there when this caravan actually arrived. And so now the story was done there. And what the prophet is not seeing when you see, they have no argument against it. So that was what happened. But as some people's faith have shaken for a moment in India because of the nature of the story. Very soon people begin to realize that actually this was the reality in that time. But let me just say that the Prophet, as you can see, he told them part of the story. The journey to Jerusalem, he told them. From Jerusalem, there, that story he held it for a while. Later, he then began to tell. And also, whatever he encountered, he didn't at once tell the story. He reserved the story and kept telling it step by point by point, sometimes when questions arise. And so if you are reading, you will come across so many stories that he narrated. And there are so many stories of what you see. He has seen the heaven. He went into it. He saw the hell. He described all the prophets that he met with. There was conversation between him and them. He spoke about war. He saw the jab. The jab, the Antichrist, as they say. Who was to come and cause havoc in this world? Prophet has seen it and he described it. And so the issue of Israel when Miraj contained a lot of stories that we will continue to hear or you will continue to read about or hear about because so many things that the Prophet has talked about what he has seen during that journey. I think we'll pause here and we will continue the rest of the story the next time when we meet. I wonder if we can allow a question. If you have any question, you can ask for that. I guess no. All right. Thank you very much. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasanah wa fil akhirati hasanah wa qina adhaban. اللهم إنا ظلمنا أنفسنا ظلما كثيرا ولا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت فاغفر لنا وارحمنا إنك أنت الغفور الرحيم ربنا إنا آمنا فاغفر لنا وارحمنا سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.